You can't just go in and say, well, I'm a ufologist. I only want to hear about the lights. I mean, come on, the whole point of this whole paranormal thing is that we don't know what's going on. So we don't know which elements are important and which ones are not. So at this point, we need to go in and collect information about everything and then look at all of it and look for patterns. You know, I tried to get Rich to do this. I was telling Rich for years, you know, this is an interesting topic. You should look into this. You should do a presentation on this on Teletubbies and Boobot. He always said, yeah, I got other things I'm working on. Maybe one day I'll do that. I don't know. And then finally I said, look, I'm going to do it. I'm just thinking if some kid were to wake up and to see a bunch of grays around their bed, they're similar enough to Boobot that if somebody said, come on out of your bed and come with us. We're going to take you for a ride. They'd be thinking, okay. And you know what? I don't want that. It's a family affair. It's a family affair. It's a family affair.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, Banal of America Audio with your host, Tim Banal.
Hello there, my friends. This is Tim Banal of banalofamerica.com with another edition of BOA Audio Season 3. It is October 27th, 2007, and this week we have a very interesting and unique interview. Our guest is one of the summer of 2007's breakout stars in the world of esoterica, Karen Dolan. Many of you may know her husband, Richard Dolan, for his fantastic work in UFO studies. But what many of you may be discovering just now is that this past summer, Karen Dolan entered the world of the esoteric and ufology, launching her own internet radio program known as Through the Keyhole, where she interviews a myriad of researchers in a wide variety of fields. Karen has a number of perspectives on the world of the esoteric and ufology, not just from being the spouse of a prominent researcher, but also from her own years of research into the field, plus new avenues that she's begun to explore. Those three elements really coalesce into making her the ideal BOA Audio guest. In this interview, we're going to be discussing what made Karen decide to enter the world of the esoteric, the dynamics of being the spouse of a UFO researcher, various aspects of her podcast series. We're going to hit a lot of the hot-button topics in ufology, such as exopolitics, women in ufology, the pros and cons of UFO conferences, the fragmentation of UFO studies, and a few other big-picture ufology questions. We're going to delve into Karen's research into the desensitization of children to the UFO phenomenon. She has just begun looking into this strange connection between children's programming and potentially embedded ET and UFO images. Plus, of course, tons and tons more. This is a jam-packed interview. For those of you who are unfamiliar with Karen Dolan, let me give you a little bit of background on her. Karen Dolan was born and raised in the Finger Lakes region of upstate New York and has had a keen interest in folklore and ghost stories all her life. She is now the host of Through the Keyhole, a weekly internet radio program devoted to ufology and the paranormal. On her show, as well as her private research, she is interested in the connections between various fringe topics, such as cryptozoology, ufology, poltergeists, and hidden history. For many years, she has engaged in in-depth studies of ancient pre-Christian religions and has a strong interest in comparative myth. Karen also provides copy editing and transcription services for various researchers and writers in the UFO paranormal field, including her husband Richard Dolan, who is author of UFOs and the National Security State. Karen lives with her husband and their two homeschooled children in Rochester, New York, and her show can be heard on ParanormalRadioNetwork.com Sunday afternoons from 5 to 7 Eastern. Her website is www.keyholepublishing.com, KeyholePublishing.com. Without any further ado, let's rock and roll. This interview was recorded on September 20th, 2007. Karen Dolan on Banal of America Audio, Season 3. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another edition of Banal of America Audio. Our guest this week is Karen Dolan. She is the host of Through the Keyhole on the Paranormal Radio Network. Many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with her husband, Richard Dolan, who is the author of UFOs in the National Security State, Volume 1. Karen Dolan emerged as a part of the esoteric scene this year, and I think personally, as someone who follows the personalities of the UFO business and the personalities of the esoteric business, I found Karen Dolan becoming a part of the scene to be as an amazing story as some of the general, you know, UFO drone picture stories that everybody's talking about. Karen was always with Richard. I saw her at the conferences and stuff, and all of a sudden she's doing her own thing, and it's really exciting, and I want to get her on the show here for season 3 to talk about her work and where it's headed. So welcome to the show, Karen.
Thank you so much, Tim. I'm really happy to be here.
Well, let's start out with your bio, your background, you know, where you came from and how you got interested in the esoteric world.
Where I came from, gosh. Well, I was born in the Rochester area, which is where Rich and I live now. He came from New York City and came up to Rochester to go to college and got stuck here. So we're still here. I've been involved in the esoteric world, I guess you could say, my whole life. I've always been interested in ghost stories about witchcraft, any kind of paranormal topics ever since I was a kid. By the time I was about 10, I think I'd read every book on the paranormal in our local library and just kind of kept going from there. Oddly enough, I never was interested in UFOs, never even came across the topic until after Rich told me he was writing his book on it. It just wasn't something I'd ever thought about. And he actually did not even want to tell anybody. He didn't tell anyone for a long time when he was writing his book because he had been in the academic world. He was working on his PhD at the University of Rochester. He was planning on becoming a history professor, and he'd already seen what kind of acceptance academicians give colleagues who try to get involved in UFOs. He said it was bad enough if you just mentioned the Kennedy assassination. So he was keeping it pretty quiet. He didn't even tell me until he was pretty well along in his research and actually starting to put the book together. And he even asked me to please keep it quiet for a while longer. So I didn't tell anybody until after he did that he was doing this, even though I thought it was pretty cool. But look, I don't see any reason to keep it quiet, but, you know, certainly respect you and do this. During the course of that, while he was writing his book, he did decide not to continue in academia and decided that he wanted to go more independently. He wanted to write this book that he felt needed to be written, and he said, you know, I'll just do my writing career. And he was kind of losing interest in teaching in an academic setting anyway. So I said, you know, why beat yourself up over this? Just do what you're going to do and get the book out and go from there and see what happens.
Yeah. Now, did he know all along that you were interested in the esoteric, or was it sort of like one day he was like, I'm working on a UFO book, and you were like, whoa, you know, I'm interested in all this other stuff.
Oh, here's my secret.
Yeah.
No, he actually knew, like, almost as soon as we met. The first time he came to my apartment when we were dating, he saw I had a ton of books on ghosts and witchcraft and all these things. I thought he was going to be really taken aback, and I thought, oh, great, I'm never going to see this guy again. Oh, man. But surprisingly, he thought it was kind of cool.
Nice. Like, as I said, you sort of emerged here this year as a new player, I guess you could say, in the field of the esoteric. Was this something that had been developing for a while, or did it just come up? Like, obviously, Richard came out with the book, and he became really well-known in the UFO field, and he's really one of the big superstars of the field now. Was it something like where you were like, wow, this is great, this is amazing, you know, I think I'm going to try and do something, or was it just sort of a spur-of-the-moment thing that came about this year?
I never thought about setting out to become a player in this. And thank you for saying those nice things about me and about Rich. Wow, that was really neat to hear.
Well, I mean it. I mean, I'm not BSing you.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it. It's still nice to hear, especially if it's true. No, and the funny thing is, I mean, Rich didn't set out to become a player in this either. He was actually doing his research in American history, which was for his PhD. You know, he was doing his doctoral dissertation research, Cold War history, political science, and he came across occasional mentions of UFOs, and they were conflicting mentions. They'd either be official statements saying, no, we looked into it, there's nothing to it, no big deal, or they'd be these super, super top secret memos saying they took this very seriously. So he just thought, well, what the heck is it? Were they serious about this or were they not? And started digging around just for his own satisfaction. pretty soon he'd accumulated so much information, he said, you know what, somebody's got to just put this in book form. So he did. But he wasn't thinking about this leading into being on the radio and being on TV and speaking at all these conferences. That it was kind of like falling into a river.
Yeah, you know,
and suddenly we're way downstream and everything's all different. But we never really planned any of this to happen.
Oh, I'm sure.
And, you know, once Rich got caught up in this, I was kind of thinking, okay, well, you know, I've always been interested in anything that we don't fully understand. You know, who built the pyramids, Coral Castle in Florida, anything like this. So to me, I thought, okay, you know, this is pretty neat, another thing to look into. Once we started with all the traveling and everything, it was like, man, everything changed. Our whole lives changed. And, of course, we had kids at the same time that his book came out. Now we have two kids, which we didn't before. And so our lives all changed because of that, too. But everything happened all at once. And I started to feel a little bit like one of our friends described it as like a ufology widow. Either I could stay home and raise the kids and try to keep a normal life going here while he went off and did his thing.
Yeah.
And I'd never see him. And we would grow farther and farther apart because, you know, when you get into this, you start getting into ufology or really serious investigation of the paranormal, the way you see the world changes.
Exactly. Yeah.
And I actually have, and I'm sure a lot of your listeners have seen, a lot of couples who get into this field don't stay together very long because your whole worldview changes. And
yeah.
If you don't both go there, you just cannot keep it together. And I started to realize that things were going to be that way. You know, I could either go with Rich and change my worldview too, or things were probably going to just be very difficult to hold together. And since it was something I was interested in anyway, it was easy for me to make the decision to do that hard work of adjusting my worldview. And, you know, Rich and I had just, we've always gone through things together.
Yeah.
You know, even when we were dating, we used to joke about being Team Dolan. And when we had the kids, you know, the team got bigger, but we really have always gone face things together.
Yeah, that's fascinating. It's a surprising turn of events, I guess, because, you know, some people write books, some people do this, some people do that, but you sort of just jump right into the radio realm, which is a whole different sort of area than what Rich is, because he's, you know, doing the writing and the lecturing. Obviously, you're doing lecturing now, too, but
yeah.
A different sort of genre in a way, the media aspect of it. So what made you decide to get into the radio part?
Well, a friend of ours, Guy Malone, who has a show called Live from Roswell on the Paranormal Radio Network, he started his show last January, 2007. Now, he'd been a friend of ours for several years since he invited Rich out to speak at his conference in Roswell a few years ago. And, in fact, he organized the whole Roswell conference this past summer as well. So he's becoming a really major player there, too. Anyway, he started his show in January, and he was lining up people that he knew in the ufology field to come on sometime and be guests. And he had already arranged with Rich that, you know, he would do an interview with Rich at some point. And then he called me and he said, you know, well, why don't you come on and you can give us a different perspective on what it's like to live with a ufologist rather than what it's like to be one. And I thought, wow, what a cool idea. And first I said, well, no, nobody's going to want to hear what I have to say. You know, you want Rich. And he said, no, because we're friends and I want to chat about, you know, what this life is like from your point of view. So I said, well, okay, you know, we went ahead and did the show, and apparently ratings were very good. You know, his producer said they were excellent for that show. So I thought, great, that was really fun. A few weeks later, I mean, I thought that was going to be the extent of my radio career. And a few weeks later, it was time for Rich to do his interview with Guy. And just before the show started, Guy called, and he said, hey, is Karen there? Can she come on, too? I said, sure. I had a lot of fun. I was hoping for another chance to get on. So the three of us did the show together. We were just chatting about stuff, and it was really fun. It was less a conventional interview than three good friends having a conversation about ufology and what it is to all of us. And once again, they told us the ratings were terrific. So I thought, well, good. You know, I had so much fun doing this. I'm really glad that people seem to enjoy listening. A few weeks after that, Guy needed a backup host. He was not able to do his show because he was at the ESTIC conference, and he wasn't able to broadcast the whole thing. So he called me up, and he said, do you want to take the first part of the show? Now, by this time, I was having kittens because I thought, oh, I'd love to do it, but I don't want to mess up your show. I'm going to destroy your show for you. And he said, no, no, you'll be great. You don't have to do that much. It's really easy. We got another friend of ours, Lisa Davis, to come on to be the guest. Well, Lisa and I have known each other for years, so I said, okay, I can get on chat with Lisa for a little bit. So we did that, and once again, the ratings were terrific. Now, by this time, Guy's producer, Joe Montaldo, was telling me at the end of the show that, you know, he kept saying, I've got time slots. Why don't you take one? You know, you're doing really well. So I thought it over because I really wasn't sure that I could do it. You know, I was really unsure of myself. But then I thought about how much fun I have every time I get on the radio. And I said, you know, it's so stupid of me to say no to this because I love it. And people seem to like what I do. And here I've got this producer with a time slot. He's begging me to take it. You know, why not just do it?
Yeah.
But if I go out there and flop, then I'll end it and he'll find somebody else to take my slot and that'll be that. But why would I not at least try it?
Exactly, yeah. And there's been a real buzz about the show and about you. Like I said, this whole year it seems like I've been hearing a lot about you. So
I think that's so funny. I just can't get over the fact that people actually enjoy hearing me sit around talk with somebody because I have such a great time doing it.
When you set about putting together the show, did you have like a specific series of guests in mind, or did you, you know, were you planning on talking to people that you already kind of knew from the field? Because you have tons of contacts through Richard,
yeah,
through all your travels and everything. So you guys know,
yeah,
a ton of people. Was it like, oh, I'm going to have all these people I know on, or was it more like, now's the opportunity to talk to a lot of people that I haven't had the chance to meet yet or chance to speak yet with and explore, you know, a whole other realm and stuff? So what went into the thought process of choosing guests and that kind of stuff?
Actually, both of those. I did feel like I wanted to take it in more of a paranormal direction, a wider range than ufology. But at the same time, I felt like, well, I already know so many people in this field that I shouldn't have any trouble lining up a guest, you know, calling up a friend to come and be on the show. But I wanted to do more than just ufology also. I listened to Coast a lot as well, and, you know, I was getting some ideas off that, the kind of topics that George Norrie and Art Bell would cover. I mean, like they did a show on Coral Castle in Florida, and I thought, oh, I want to do that.
Yeah.
Get somebody on. Right now I'm actually looking for someone to talk about hauntings. Like I'm thinking Borley Rectory would be a really fun one to do because I've always found that really fascinating. So I'm trying to find an individual right now who'd be a good person to talk about that.
That's one of the good parts about having sort of like an independent show like you and I both have is that as a student of the esoteric, it's a great vehicle to learn so much more stuff because, like, I'm kind of the same way. I'll be listening to Coast, or if I'm at the bookstore and I see a book, you know, it's not just like, oh, this will be a cool book to read. Now it's like, this would be a great book to read, and then I'll get in touch with the guy and bring him on the show, and we can talk about even more, and I'll find out more information. It's really, it opens up a great avenue for further research.
Isn't that fun?
Oh, it's the best.
And I used to be so shy around authors, I would never think that I could actually contact somebody who wrote a book. You know, that was just so intense for me. I when I was growing up, I was really, really shy. And that's why my parents, I think, couldn't believe for a while that I was actually on the radio. Like, you're talking to people. And the first time I told my parents, you know, I was doing the show, and, oh, yeah, I got about 30,000 listeners, and some were in the U.K., and I had a few call in from Australia. And they're just like, what?
Wow, that's really cool.
Yeah.
Speak a little bit to that transition, I guess, from spectator outside the public eye to presenter personality aspect. Like you said, it was so weird that there was this buzz about the show, and we were just talking about sort of how it opens up all these new avenues for exploration. Talk a little bit about what it's like to go from spectator to presenter.
Well, it's sort of been making the transition for a while. When I first went to conferences with Rich, nobody knew who I was.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was like this nobody. They probably assumed I was his wife, but no one expected me to know anything or to do anything other than, you know, like that I had come along for the trip. And they probably expected me to go out someplace else while the conference was going on. I think I surprised a few people that I actually stayed and listened to the presentations and asked questions. But at that time, I didn't know anything about UFOs or about the history of the field or any of this. I mean, despite the fact that Rich had written this definitive history, and I had helped him do some editing, but I hadn't at that point, I had not really read through even his entire book. I had read most of it, but it was all in bits and pieces. I hadn't, like, sat down and read the entire book straight through. And his book has so much information, it was really overwhelming. I actually couldn't take it all in at first. Since then, I mean, that was years ago, I have read almost every book that he used as research for that.
Oh, wow.
I've read a lot of other books on the subject. I've talked to these people. I've met all these authors. I've listened to their radio interviews. So, you know, I kid people. I say, well, you can't live in a house with Rich Dolan and not eventually know something about the history of ufology.
Yeah.
You know, it's not possible. I've seen all the DVDs. Whenever he's on a documentary or something, I watch it. And, of course, they always have lots of other people on there, too. So I get a good overview of a lot of different opinions and a lot of different information. So, and then each time we went to a conference, I'd be able to participate a little more and a little more and a little more. So people were kind of starting to see me as at least a person who is interested in this topic.
Yeah.
And not just as a wife who tags around after her husband. Because sometimes when husbands go to business conferences, their wives might go along, but they'll go off sightseeing while their husbands are in their meetings.
Yeah, yeah.
And I really think that's what people thought I was going to do at first, but.
Yeah, well, you do see that with, people who come to the conferences, they bring other people and that kind of thing, family and stuff.
Well, sure, and it's fair enough that not everyone in the family has the same interest.
Yeah. It just worked out really well for you guys.
It just happened that we do, you know. Although, you know, Rich is really interested in the government aspects and the historical aspects and the cover-ups and all of this, and I'm really not.
Yeah, that's actually what I was going to ask you about next. We should plug the UFO Magazine interview. Wow, when's that coming out, like next month?
November.
November.
I understand.
Literally in November, or is it like coming out in
October?
Well,
November issue. I was told it'll be out in the November issue, and actually I was told that it might be in two issues because I got a little carried away when I was writing my answers, and I guess they were kind of long, so it might get split.
I was saying before we started the show, I was lucky enough to get a copy of the interview already because, of course, Leslie of Been All of America conducted the interview for her column in UFO Magazine, so check it out if you're listening, and you can get out at the newsstand. Definitely pick it up. It's a great interview, and I've tried to not overlap too many of the questions. Mm-hmm. And one of the points that was in the interview was what you had just said, that Richard's really into the conspiracy aspect of the UFO phenomenon, the cover-up part of it, the government elements to it, and you're more interested in sort of the more ephemeral nature of it, you know, where the aliens are coming from, if they're coming here, you know, what's their deal, what's their agenda. Talk a little bit about that, and I also wanted to ask you sort of like, is there anything that you and Richard disagree about? Is there anything that you're like, that's like sort of like the joke of the house, you know, where you're like, you know, that Kenneth Arnold story doesn't add up, and Richard's like, no, it does, or anything like that.
Oh, Tim, we don't disagree on anything ever. I knew I couldn't say that with a straight face. Okay. You know, oddly enough, I don't think there are. I'm trying to think of some major point that we do disagree on, and I'm. Oh my gosh, we do agree on everything. I'll be darned. Well, as far as, what we're interested in, now I'm going to be distracted because I'm still thinking about
that. Yeah, that was more of a jokey sort of thing. There's nothing to crop circles. Yes, there is, something like that. But talk about your divergent interest as far as the UFO phenomenon goes.
Yeah. See, well, Rich, as I told you, he got into it through his academic research in history.
Mm-hmm.
And he's studying politics, and he's studying politicians and how they work with each other and how they handle information and how they cover up some information and they release some information. And that's his whole thing, is human beings and what we do with this information. And what I've always been interested in is not so much in people and what they choose to do with this stuff as what is the nature of reality and what is out there and what other beings are there and what might they be doing here. So our interests really run parallel, and we read a lot of the same books, but we read them to get different things out of them.
Yeah. You're an advocate for a more blended mix of esoterica, cryptozoology, ufology, all these other elements, you know, not just a specialization like we see a lot of times.
And I want to make clear that I think specialization is really, really important because it's impossible to dig deeply enough to uncover new information on something unless you really specialize in that one area.
Mm-hmm.
However, having said that, this is really important. I'm glad that you gave me an opportunity to say this because I feel really strongly about this one. I've heard a lot of researchers recently coming down hard on other researchers for being the other of these two kinds. There's the kind of researcher who chooses one case or one topic and they dig and dig and dig and dig and they can uncover all kinds of new information. But they don't look at anything other than that one focused topic. And then there are people who are accused of being armchair researchers who take the facts and the information that other people uncover and they put it in context. Rich has been attacked by several people for not going out and interviewing people himself, but for pulling up other sources and correlating information that's been in other people's books. Now, I mean, first of all, when he did it with the one book that he's completed that's been published already, a lot of the sources that he used were out of print. They were older things. They were almost impossible for him to find. So what he was really doing was preserving some very important information that was almost not available anymore to any researchers.
Yeah.
So first of all, that point needed to be made, I think, that he really did a huge service to the field by preserving some of the earliest work that I know he spent months working with used book dealers here in Rochester and all over the country, actually. He had people tracking things down for him. Some of them took over a year to find a book.
Oh, wow.
Now, that kind of thing, you know, the information that's in those books when he finally did get hold of them, you know, now it's available again to any other researcher who comes out. And this is stuff that would have been lost. Just completely, you know, maybe available in a couple of private book collections here and there, but he really wanted this to be preserved and to be made available.
Yeah.
And he did. And he also took all these different sources and he correlated the information. You know, he put it all into context with each other. And that's one thing I really feel that is necessary. And I would take it even a step farther. And I would say, for example, in the Skinwalker Ranch case in Utah, I believe it is.
Yeah.
You know, there's a case where you have UFO activity, you've got poltergeist activity, there are strange creatures that maybe cryptozoologists would be interested in. But how on earth is anybody supposed to figure out what's going on in that ranch unless they all work together or unless at least someone is willing to look at all of the phenomena? You can't just go in and say, well, I'm a ufologist, so I only want to hear about the lights.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't tell me about anything else. I mean, come on, the whole point of this whole paranormal thing is that we don't know what's going on. So we don't know which elements are important and which ones are not. So at this point, we need to go in and collect information about everything and then look at all of it and look for patterns.
What do you think we can do to sort of lessen that dichotomy between the two camps, between, you know, the people who want to keep everything in separate sort of realms and the people who want to do a mix?
I mean, the only thing I can see, the only thing I've been able to think of is just to talk a lot about how important both sides are.
Yeah.
Because really, I mean, saying you're going to look at all the information and put it all in context will only go so far if there's no one out there digging as deeply as some of these people do and actually coming out with the new information. And there is no way to get some of this information unless you spend years focusing on a single case. And God bless the people who do that. I don't think I'd be able to because I just keep hopping around. I keep finding something else that's interesting, and I can't stick with one thing that long.
Yeah.
But I really admire the people who can. But it's funny, you know, when Rich was doing his research, he'd be talking about a UFO case, and I'd say, gosh, that's funny. That sounds just like poltergeist activity. And he'd say, really? Because he didn't know, he hadn't read as many ghost stories as I had. And I'd say, yeah, poltergeists do that sort of thing. Or, gosh, that's near water. You find a lot of poltergeist activity near water. You know, and we'd find things like that, that where you'd find this crossover, and that's what really got me interested and noticing that there were some researchers who really don't believe in doing that.
Exactly, yeah. Now, do you think that trend sort of is changing? It seems like there's At least more people coming on the horizon and who are advocating sort of more of a mix. And like you said, with the Skinwalker book, that sort of is a really good template for what really needs to sort of happen with more of a mix of subjects. Do you think that the mood is changing, I guess?
I do.
With regards to that attitude.
Yeah, I do. I really do see, in the last year or so, I've seen a lot more, for example, radio shows that don't just focus on ufology but cover ufology and the paranormal. No, just signs that people are beginning to group these things under the same larger heading and accepting the fact that maybe they're related in ways that we don't really understand yet. I mean, maybe they are different, but gosh, Jacques Vallée was saying a long time ago that the old fairy stories sure sounded like modern stories of alien abductions. And he said maybe we shouldn't be calling them fairies or aliens. Maybe they're the same being and maybe they're something completely different than what we've thought they were. The thing that really irritates me is when people come out and say, well, we know who they are and we know where they came from and we know why they're here. I'm like, I don't. You know, I'm glad you do, but I don't. And that worries me because people are saying things like, you know, there's some individuals who say, oh, well, if they come and tell us we should do something, then we should just do it because they're here to help us.
Yeah.
Well, no, not necessarily. I mean, maybe they're just really good liars. I would need more proof. I mean, maybe they are here to help us, and maybe we should listen to them, but I'm not convinced yet.
Kind of keeping in subject with the dichotomy aspect, what about the ongoing debate within ufology or the sort of exopolitical aspect versus the science aspect? Obviously, I'm in favor of sort of them working together, but it seems like that only happens in small doses. What do you think of that sort of activist nature versus science nature of ufology, and what side really has the advantage, I guess you could say?
Okay, so you're talking about the researchers. You're not talking about whatever beings are out there. You're talking about the researchers who believe in
the sort of trend in ufology it sort of has become kind of a debate in the last 10 years or so over should we be, you know, trying to get active about this and alerting people and getting the government involved and stuff like that and trying to – the exopolitical part. And then there's the other side that says, you know, that's pointless. It's never going to happen. Let's focus on the nuts and bolts of this and you know, those exopolitical people are crazy. It gets, you know how it is in ufology. Then it turns ugly.
We just came back from the exopolitics conference. So, yes, I know exactly how that is. You know, once again, I'm going to say I think everybody's right. And I think we do need the scientific, a really close investigation of what facts we do have, because we're trying to figure out what's out there. You know, it's here, they are here, whoever. We want to know who this is, where they came from, what are we dealing with exactly. Now, we're all at a point, we're talking about a group of people who's at a point of being well past believing that those lights in the sky are something. You know, when an individual first comes across the ufology topic, it's, is that light in the sky really moving? Is it really not the planet Venus or a satellite or something like that? That's the really, really basic end of it. And, you know, when we were at the exopolitical conference, somebody pointed out that we were all so far past that. We're all up at a point of saying, okay, yes, UFOs are real. There is life elsewhere, and that life is here. And now we're saying, how are we going to deal with it? So, yeah, I do believe that the exopolitical faction is correct in saying if life from elsewhere, whether it's another dimension or another galaxy or whatever, if life from somewhere else is here, yes, we sure as heck better figure out how we are going to interact with this life. In order to do that, we need to know something about them. We need to know if they're here to eat us or if they're here ignoring us. Do they want something else on our planet? Are we on the way to something else for them? Do they just stop off to rest on the way to something completely unrelated? I mean, that's going to affect how we deal with them.
Yeah.
And the way we determine that is through the science, the nuts and bolts, analyzing what we do have. Then we go back to the exopolitical side, which says the government should be releasing what information they have. And that's absolutely true. The government should be telling us, because then we'd have a lot more information that we would be able to use to figure out who we're dealing with, which in turn would let us know how we should deal with them. So, yeah, everybody's right. We need all of this information.
Yeah.